Australia is facing an unprecedented decline in biodiversity, as is the globe. And one of the challenges is that there's a huge amount of uncertainty in terms of how to deal with that biodiversity loss. There's also a limited amount of resources that we can use to tackle those problems. And at the same time, there's a lot of competing other problems that we're trying to deal with around the world that are taking up those same resources. So we have a very challenging set of problems to deal with in Australia, and we're trying to do it in the best way possible with the resources that we have at hand. Amongst the threats to Australian biodiversity, there's two that are key, and that is habitat loss and fragmentation, and the introduction of exotic species. In terms of managing those threats, there's many actions we can take, but the first one is to remove the threat entirely. So in terms of habitat loss, it's removing the destruction of habitat, and for invasive species, it's preventing entry into Australia. Other actions we can take for habitat loss include restoration, active restoration, putting vegetation and animals back into the landscape. And in terms of invasive species, we want to contain their distribution once they come into Australia. And then if they start to spread, we want to control that spread. There are many other threats facing Australia. Livestock grazing and misuse of fire are two other big ones. Grazing affects over 80% of the Australian landscape, and by managing stock density, we can go a long way towards maintaining biodiversity in these landscapes. In terms of fire, fire frequencies have become too frequent in many parts of the Australian landscape and also too extensive. So by understanding Aboriginal fire regimes, we're trying to get back to something more in tune with what the fire regimes were prior to European colonization. Over the last 10 years or so, we've developed a lot of techniques to help us make better decisions in the face of this high level of uncertainty and resource constraints. And we call this process of decision making called structured decision making. There's a few key steps that we take when we're using this process, and they are firstly to clearly define the problem that we have. The second thing we need to do is clearly articulate what actions we're actually going to take. What can we do to protect biodiversity in these different circumstances? The next thing we need to do is ask ourselves, well, what's the actual benefit of taking that action? If we, for example, are going to minimize grazing in a particular area, what's going to be the benefit of that grazing response on the plants and animals that we're trying to protect? Finally, we need to think about what the resource constraints are. Often we try and solve these problems without having an understanding of the costs of undertaking the different actions, and that's really like trying to go shopping without price tags. So we need to know, how much money do we have to deal with this particular problem, and how much time do we have? What's the time frame in terms of solving this type of problem? We're using these methods of structured decision making to solve some very tricky problems in Australia, and they include how to recover our endangered species. At the moment, we have over 700 species listed on the EPBC, that's the Environmental Protection and Biodiversity Conservation Act. We don't have enough resources to recover all of those species, so we need to come up with a way of actually deciding which ones we can recover for the resources we have. So using this technique is a very helpful way of doing that. We can define the costs of taking the different actions, we can define the benefits for each species of taking these actions, and we can also look at the feasibility. The reason why this approach has been so successful is that we're essentially producing a prospectus for investing in biodiversity. And this is really useful when we're working with government agencies and industry bodies, in that we're able to say, this is how much biodiversity you're likely to conserve for this amount of money spent.
My name's Eddie Game. I'm a senior scientist with the Nature Conservancy, which is the world's largest conservation non-government organization. We work in about 45 countries around the world on biodiversity conservation strategies. In Australia, we work in the Kimberley and we support conservation management in a number of Indigenous protected areas. This is the same place where CSIRO has been working to determine the most cost-effective approaches to managing our biodiversity. We use CSIRO's products. That's one of the big reasons why people support the Nature Conservancy, is that we're really committed to using science to determine the work we do, and it's a big incentive for our supporters that we're always looking for the most cost-effective approaches to biodiversity conservation. In the Kimberley, this turns out to be for us managing fire regimes, managing cattle on those lands, and also managing invasive herbivores.
Many of the problems that we have right now in terms of biodiversity conservation are very urgent, and failure to make decisions in a timely way will lead to extinction. In fact, one of our most recent extinctions was the Christmas Island pipistrelle, and that's a species that we had been monitoring for quite a long time, but a failure to act in time resulted in the extinction of that species. We want to avoid that in the future. We have the tools at hand to make decisions under huge amounts of uncertainty. Australia is very well placed in terms of managing its biodiversity because a lot of the scientific expertise is being developed in this country. So given the political will and the social appetite for biodiversity conservation is there, we should do very well in halting the decline of our biodiversity and recovering the biodiversity that is already in decline.